Good morning. I want to thank Pastor Bonner for this opportunity to speak a few words for our Master, Jesus, God's Son. First of all, let me say I give thanks to God Almighty for placing me at this point in the sanctuary. And as I said, I thank Reverend Bonner for this opportunity, and I also thank my wife, who is an encouragement, saying you can do it. Thank you. All right. First, we'll have our two verses of Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. I love that. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound at Father, thank you for waking us up this morning, breathing your word in our hearts and minds. For you gave the angels charge over our souls last night. You kept the enemy from our doorstep so we could sleep in peace in Jesus. Thank you, Father God, just for another day added to those days that you've given to us already on the calendar. Grant, Holy Spirit, to speak a word of truth to your people. I ask it in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. You'll need your Bibles. We'll be talking from John 21, 15 through 17. In that 21st chapter, there is three paragraphs, and it seems like a short one to make four or three and a half. And we usually stand when God's word is read from the Holy Scriptures. I'll read just 15, because we have different translations of the Bible. I'll be reading from the King James, and you can read along as well. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" And he responds and says, "Yea, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." You may be seated. Message title, Peter, feed my sheep. And we're going to do a sub which says, Breakfast at the Galilee Diner. A question and answer dialogue between the Lord and Peter concerning giving reasonable service to the Lord, the kingdom. This is the vineyard where we work. Our message opens at breakfast time on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. This is also known as the Sea of Tiberias. Now, this third time, the Lord has shown himself after his resurrection. Present, seven disciples present. The disciples had been fishing all night. Futile at first, but after Jesus appeared unto them, then commanded their nets to be thrown over the right side, never the left. But after Jesus appeared unto them, then commanded them to cast their nets over the right side of the ship. An abundance of fish filled the nets, too heavy to haul in by those on board. Thereby, they were using another boat. 21:8. During breakfast by the seashore, the dialogue ensues. First time, 21:15. Jesus asked Simon, "Do you love me?" His reply was, "You know that I love you," Simon said. Then Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Second time, Jesus said, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me?" Jesus said to him again, Simon's answer, "Thou knowest that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Third time, Jesus asked Simon, did he love him? The answer again is, "Yea, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Then said to him, "Feed my sheep." By this third time, Simon is getting a little perturbed. He's getting a little shaking. When Jesus asked him that three times and he gave him the same answer. But Simon is kind of feeling put on the spot. Let's clarify a few terms here if we may. Agapeo, Greek love, two Greek verbs. Love, agape, means to deeply as a divine love, as our love for Christ and his love for us. Phileo, love means to be fond of, your best friend, your family members, to a lesser degree. Let's paraphrase that. Do you, Peter, love these? These here are the disciples with him as between friends. Another word comes from this is flock. The term combines the two groups, sheep and lambs. Sheep, mature adults, seniors who have feasted on the word for many years. This many years is like a mother who prayed for a son who's gone astray, or daughter, 30, 40 years, didn't give up. It seems to reason, senior would need more food to grow on than the babes. Stop. The babes are the lambs. These are the young ones, and they need milk. They're not ready for the meat. It'll be a while on that. But they need a lot of milk. It seems to reason seniors would need more food to grow on than the babes. That's why we encourage to our Sunday school, Bible study, other church activities where the Word of God is taught from the top down. Pastors, ministers, parents, teachers, missionaries, etc., etc. We see here at 21:15, with Christ's threefold repetition of the word, my lambs, my sheep, reminds all Christians who have responsibility over others that the persons under them belong first of all to Christ. I've heard some people say, oh, my people, these are my people. No, they're not your people. These are Christ's sheep, lest we forget. Hebrews 13:22, 1 Peter 5 and 3, 3 and 17. I'm going to go back for a second. Peter's confidence is shaken when he, having recently denied the Lord three times. That's what was bothering him. Now beware of his own weakness, Peter. He dare not answer with a strong word like agapeo. This is among friends. But then he uses the lesser Greek word phileo, which means to be fond of, as between friends. Are we friends of God? We the sheep? Yes, we are, most definitely. John 11:15 says, we're no longer servants, but I call you my friends. That's wonderful. Acts 20:28 says, take heed there unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. Aren't you glad to be in this flock? Tell you, overseers, here again for emphasis, pastors, teachers, missionaries, laymen, parents, etc. Jesus now condescends, parenthesis, to come willingly and graciously to the level of one's inferior. So to brought himself down to Peter's level. To patronize, to Peter's own self-evaluation, saying in effect, Peter, even if you don't trust your emotions, you still should feed my sheep. That's emotion when we kind of think a little too highly of ourselves and we start to go like this, right? But we got to come down when the master speak to your heart. Our duty to Christ should depend not on the strength of our subjective feelings, emotions again, but on to our realization of quite as what Christ has done for us. What did he do for us? Out of love, the proper motive is for service. What did he do for us? Speaking of sheep, our Father chose the lowly, the meek lamb, as sacrifice on Calvary's cross. Yeah. like a meek lamb gone to slaughter. That brings us to the part of the scripture where the lamb is led to the slaughter. First, they put up a scapegoat, and they have a gate that's going to be split. Scapegoat goes up the ramp, off to the side. He's turned into the wilderness. The real lamb that's going to be going to slaughter goes this way. That ties in with the part of the scripture that said, he never said a mumbling word. As he struggles under the burden of the cross, down the streets, through the old city, one street is called the Via della Rosa. Another is called the Street of Sorrows. He's on his way to Golgotha's Hill, where evil men would lay him down, and he offers him flesh, his flesh, where the nails would be driven in. 6-inch Roman spike. If you spiritualize this, you can hear the sound of the hammer driving in this 6-inch spike in live flesh. He suffered. He suffered. The throng just the other day was shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna. Welcome, King of the Jews. Now this crowd is shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Here they have left the trial, but let me go back just a second or two. When they had the trial there, and the crowd, they're bloodthirsty by now. The Hebrew custom was, on a day like that, they would let or release one criminal go. And Jesus was here. Barabbas is here. And the crowd is saying, who do you think they're going to let go? Give us Barabbas. Not Jesus. We're going to crucify him. These are, Jesus is condemned by the very people that he had come to save from their sins. Aren't we flip-flop? He is nailed to the cross, lifted up in all his humility. His nakedness is shown in shame. The gaping crowd sought to have him come down and saying things like, if you really call yourself God's son, you come down and save yourself. Yeah. Little did they know that it was all for them. Some even took it as a leisure time to cast lots. Our present day is dice. For his robe, four generals, rather than split the robe, it's in one piece, four ways, let's do this to get the robe. He would not come down because he was carrying out the commandment of his father, that it is to die for all mankind. In this greatest act of love on the cross was the greatest sacrifice a father could have his son to make. Jesus paid the price for us souls, because God loved man And his master plan was to get him back. Get him back. So he dresses himself in human flesh. This is the veil. Come down to earth and be born as a babe. Grow up. Take his place. And the word tells us, when they ask him, I've got to be about my Father's business. No other reason I came. I got to be about my Father's business. What is that? To go about, preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and him crucified. In this greatest act of love on the cross was the greatest sacrifice the Father could have his Son to make. He is offered vinegar water to drink. Matthew 27:34. He declines. He is pierced in the side. Out come blood and water poured forth. Water for the baptism. Precious blood for the remission of sin. Symbolic of the Holy Spirit, the water. Precious blood for the remission of sin, past, present, future. Our Lord, compassionate that he is, gave to one sinner on the right, never on the left, stop dying when he said to him, this day, not next week, not tomorrow, this day, you'll be with me in paradise. And that goes for all of us sheep. The same saying, when we close our eyes down here, you're in the Lord's presence. That's what Paul told us. You're there. Don't fret. Don't worry about death taking over. But we shall live on the other side of the pit, alive and doing well, in those mansions that have already been in place. When he left, he said, I'm going to send you somebody, the Comforter. But I'm going, what did he say? To prepare a place for you and you and all you sheep. Hallelujah. This day, paradise. God would have Jesus stay on the cross. If there was only one sinner in the world to save, Scripture says, what love has our Savior for us sinners? The earth shook like never before. Fear gripped the people around the cross. Some believed and some not believed. They were saying, come down. Some thought it was even the end of the world. John was there. His mother Mary and the rest of his family stood a little ways off. Part of the seven was, you'll notice that Jesus could not address his mother as Mary. He said instead, woman, observe your son. Because in those days, woman was the phrase that was used because women in that society was considered property. Jesus dies on the cross. He gives up the ghost, his spirit, with the words to his Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. got real dark, ground shaking like never before. Some thought, secondly, that the world was coming to an end. He says to his father, "Into thy hands I commit my spirit. I'll be coming home soon. I'll be coming home." Jesus had made this supreme sacrifice, which God had demanded for us, for our souls. By his death, we have eternal life. God's plan to bring man back to himself through the resurrection. After a while, Pilate releases the body to Joseph of Arimathea, one of his disciples, for burial in his new tomb. Joseph had hewn this tomb for himself. So when his time came, he would be put there. But instead, he gives something new to the situation, to Jesus. 3 days, 3 nights in the heart of the earth, he's buried. Early Sunday morning, real early, sunrise, saw our Christ rise from the grave. He's alive forevermore. God has raised his son as he was prophesied. He is risen. He's alive forevermore. Resurrection. Hallelujah. With all power in his hands and in heaven and in the earth. And let me stop there just for a moment. When he rose, Mary came to the tomb with some oil to anoint the body. She thought he was a gardener. Oh, no, Mary. This is the real thing. By Jesus addressing her by her first name tells us that he will address us, we sheep, by our name. We got a special name anyway. But Mary, that says he appeared to a believer, a saved soul person. Mary, this is the example that he'll appear to all of us on the other side. With all power in his hands in the heavens and in the earth, never to die again. He only did it once. In the days of old, the priests used to do it once, twice a year when it was their turn to serve in the temple. But this lamb, only once, only once, will rise, we will rise at his second advent, second coming, because he promised to come back. But in the meantime, I'm going to send you a comforter. But I'm coming back to get you. That's the church. All believers in the Lord Jesus Christ and him only. This other stuff is worldly. Forget it. It's not going to take you anywhere. O death, where's thy sting? The sting of death is the law that we try to obey to get right. You can't do that, especially without the Holy Spirit in your temple. But it don't become a temple until Christ's Spirit move in. Otherwise, it's just a piece of dirt. After 40 days, our Christ continued his earthly ministry. And then it was time to go home and take up his glory like he left before. Take up his glory. And God is saying, "Son, you've done your job. It's time to come on home. I miss you. Shekinah glory cloud, step on board. I got to leave you. Disciples about to have a fit. Don't leave us. We won't have anybody. I got to go. God says, not at your home. Take your rightful seat right here at my right hand. Yeah. Where you, Jesus, will reign forever. Next in the order of events, we be called home on that judgment day. And we'll be going to a wedding, the wedding feast of the Lamb. He's got to come and get his bride because he's the king, right? You need a queen. And the bride is the church, a body of believers, sheep, nevertheless. Go get your bride, son. It's time. It's time because no man knows when he's coming back. That's the kicker. Nobody. There are a group of people call themselves date setters. Oh, you know, the world is going to come to an end on December the 14th and on they go. And when it don't happen, they start all over again after they get the money. Well, when he come for his church, body of believers, we're all going to the wedding feast of the Lamb. And he will become the Passover meal. We're going to feast on him. And he's going to tell us all these things that the old prophets wish they knew. And the present day people upon the earth who wish that they knew what God was doing. But to us, the sheep, the believers, we'll know. We won't have to guess. Welcome to the wedding, coming soon. I think I'm all done now. Thank you for your time. All right.